Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
He was convicted of attempted murder in a 2005 shootout with Chicago police that left him severely wounded. Tonight, a former railroad agent and police officer is sentenced to 40 years behind bars. Well, good evening, everybody. Howard Morgan was convicted of shooting and injuring two Chicago police officers during a traffic stop.
Howard Morgan was shot 28 times by officers. Now, tonight, his family's vowing to appeal his sentence. ABC 7's Evelyn Holmes joining us with more on this case. Evelyn?
Well, some consider the 40-year prison sentence a judge gave Howard Morgan during an overflow crowd of protesters and Chicago police the right punishment for the crime. He could have received up to 80 years. Still, the family and supporters of the former Chicago police officer say this afternoon's decision was indeed a miscarriage of justice.
I would just like some justice for my husband.
A tearful Rosalind Morgan reacts to the 40-year prison sentence given to her husband, Howard Morgan. He's the man shot 28 times by Chicago police officers during a traffic stop.
Our family is in pain, and right now what's important is to free Howard Morgan and to bring him home.
A now 61-year-old Morgan sat quietly in court, saying before Cook County Judge Clayton Crane handed down a sentence in connection with the 2005 incident, "God bless my wife and family. It's all in God's hands." Morgan was an officer for the Burlington Northern Santa Fe line and was off duty when he was pulled over by officers for driving the wrong way on a one-way street. What happened next depends on who you ask.
He pulled out a gun. He shot at officers 17 times. He hit three officers. He deserves to go to prison.
Prosecutors say Morgan, a former Chicago cop himself, began shooting at officers when they tried to arrest him. But his supporters say the incident and verdict smacks of racism.
There was only two African Americans on the jury, and the rest of them was white. There is an injustice today.
During his victim impact statement, Officer John Wrigley angrily said, as dozens of his fellow officers looked on, "You shot me, Mr. Morgan. You came close to ending my life." Morgan was hospitalized for 7 months and was later charged with attempted murder, aggravated battery, and aggravated discharge of a firearm at a police officer. In 2007, a jury acquitted him of most of the charges, but deadlocked on the attempted murder charges. A judge declared a mistrial, and Morgan was tried again. This time, he was found guilty of attempted murder. The jury was not allowed to hear about Morgan's prior acquittal.
When America judge disregards a law that was written and passed, and yet it says double jeopardy is not double jeopardy.
Supporters of Howard Morgan say jurors should not hear all the evidence and that he was never tested for gun residue. The group change.org has begun a petition drive to get his conviction overturned. Meanwhile, the family is pursuing a civil lawsuit in federal court against the officers, and they are even thinking about having the Justice Department get involved.
All right. Thank you for that, Evelyn.
It's All Things Considered from NPR News. I'm Audie Cornish.
I'm Melissa Block, and we begin this hour with testimony in court today about the mass shooting at an Aurora, Colorado movie theater last summer. Today, a series of police officers described the moments before and after the arrest of James Holmes, who's charged in the shootings. Holmes faces 166 counts of murder, attempted murder, and other offenses. The July shooting left 12 dead and at least 58 injured. Victims and their families were in court today as prosecutors began laying out their case in the preliminary hearing. Colorado Public Radio's Megan Verlee was also in the courtroom, and she joins me now. Megan, tell us more about what was presented at this hearing today.
Well, today was really a parade of police officers who were on scene the night of the attack, laying out what happened. The officers who arrested Holmes described first seeing him outside the theater. Several of them mistook him for a police officer because he was wearing so much ballistic gear. They described that he was completely compliant when they did arrest him. One officer actually described him as relaxed and disassociated from what was happening around him. So for the first time, the public's gotten a sense of what the police officer saw that night. They also describe truly horrific scenes within the theater itself, just massive amounts of blood and bodies and people running and screaming. It sounded like a tremendously chaotic and traumatizing evening. Several of the officers actually started crying on the stand as they described transporting victims.
Well, a Washington, D.C. police officer was arrested here in Pittsburgh after he allegedly threatened a Port Authority bus driver.
And he was allegedly so combative, police say they had to use a taser to subdue him. KD investigator Marty Griffin is live with a story. Marty.
And police describe it as a dangerous situation. Imagine this, a big man wildly swinging a police baton at a Port Authority driver, scared the daylights out of passengers. In fact, Port Authority police here in minutes, they had to taser the man, arrest the man, who turns out to be a Washington, D.C. police officer. The Port Authority bus was packed with passengers. There were no empty seats when the bus pulled in here late Friday night. According to police, a Washington, D.C. police officer, William Anderson III, pulled out his expandable baton, swinging it wildly when told he would stand or wait for another bus if he wanted on this particular bus. Police reports indicate the D.C. police officer yelled, "Are you disrespecting me? I'm a cop. I deserve respect." Port Authority police arrived. The D.C. police officer blamed the bus driver, stating, "He threatened me." Port Authority police who made the arrest say the suspect refused to drop the baton and stepped towards me. A Port Authority police officer used a taser on the suspect. Still, according to police, the suspect was very combative towards officers. Witnesses say bus passengers were so concerned about their safety, they stood and cheered Port Authority police once they had the D.C. police officer in custody. That police officer, William Anderson III, charged with reckless endangerment, terroristic threats, and harassment. Turns out he's on leave and he's here in Pittsburgh as a graduate student at Carnegie Mellon University. Reporting live, Marty Griffin, KDKA TV News.
Context of White Supremacy. Justice Gus T Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Wednesday, January 9th, 2012, so I have been told. Should be back tomorrow, same program time, tune in. Actually, we should be back tomorrow, Friday, and Saturday, so tune in, constructive info on the way, context of white supremacy. Headset, can get that request out. Cannot believe I'm having to ask again for a headset. I just got a brand new one, and it is defective. I'm not sure what happened. I'd only had it not even 2 months, I don't think, and it is not working. So headset, you can definitely get that via the wish list. Would be a much happier victim of racism, white supremacy, with my headset. Gus T Renegade on Amazon.com. Getting to today's broadcast, the sound clips that we began things with, the first report, victim of racism, white supremacy, Mr. Howard Morgan, black male, the incident that happened in Chicago, where enforcement officers fired at him over 20 times. I mean, that's not even news anymore. Enforcement officers firing dozens, even over 100 rounds at a black person. That's not even anything to wink at anymore at this point. But he actually was convicted in this incident. Typically, as with happens with regards to police enforcement officers mauling, abusing, tasing, stomping, kicking, beating down, killing black people in those circumstances, typically from what I've seen, sodomizing, don't forget that one, Abner Louima, the enforcement officers, the white enforcement officers that are typically involved, nothing generally happens to them. Not that I expect it to, but that's generally the way it goes down. Unfortunately, with the case with Mr. Morgan, he actually got convicted, 40-year sentence, Chicago, Illinois. The clip, the second audio clip that played, the Colorado shooter, white terrorist, James Combs, that is front page news again, as they're in the arraignment phase of the trial So you're hearing, they're having daily reports from what was, what testimony was given from enforcement officers present and victims and blah, blah, blah. The interesting thing, and this stood out to me even before I got more information about our guest for today's broadcast, but when they, and I heard this even from this summer, when they saw this white man, racist suspect, who just shot up the theater and has got all of this high-tech weaponry and booby traps set up in his residence, that they thought he was one of them. They didn't identify him as a terrorist when they saw him. They just thought, oh, he's one of us, got to be on our team. I just thought it was a stark contrast to the way that black people generally are approached in those situations. Even if you remember the incident that happened in San Francisco where the black male was shot and killed and left to bleed to death in the street. They didn't treat James Holmes in that manner in Colorado after he had just killed, was it 12 people and shot dozens more? They didn't treat him the same way. Didn't use the same language to describe him. I still don't think I've heard him described as a terrorist. You move to the final clip involving our guest for today's program. He didn't kill anyone. Mr. Howard Morgan didn't kill anybody either. But our guest for today's broadcast, who didn't abuse anyone, didn't hurt anyone, no violence came from our guest for today's program. He was charged with making terroristic threats, among other things, just for being a victim of racism, white supremacy, and attempting to use public transportation under the dominance of racist man, racist woman, racist child. I thought it would be helpful, hopefully constructive and informative, to hear more information from him, seeing as he is an enforcement officer in Washington, D.C., what types of racism, white supremacy he observes as an officer in the D.C. area, more information about his situation specifically, and what we can learn from that moving forward. Real pleasure to have him on the broadcast. Joining us live, our guest, Mr. William Anderson III. Mr. Anderson, are you with us?
How you doing? Greetings, Gus, and Justice.
Grand. Thank you for sharing a bit of your Wednesday evening. Really excited about having you on the program. I feel like I've had to give this disclaimer many times for many guests. Wish it could have been under better circumstances, us hooking up and meeting, but, you know, glad to have you on the broadcast, and hopefully it will be constructive for all. Before we get started with your situation, is there any background information that you think folks should know about you before we proceed?
I am a police officer, as you know. I'm a current graduate student at CMU, studying, ironically, public policy, and a huge component of that is law enforcement. Other than that, I mean, I actively am engaged in my community in Washington, D.C. I live in Washington, D.C. I mentor, again, I very much work in the same area that I live in. So, I'm a part of my community.
I mean, just for folks, you are a black male.
Absolutely. I'm a black male.
Right on. This broadcast, Context of White Supremacy, I have unfortunately concluded that we're in a global system of white supremacy racism. Use those two terms as synonyms. The definition I use for both terms is as follows: a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you believe that such a system exists? And do you think that's an accurate definition?
I definitely believe that such a system exists. The definition, I just disagree with one word, and that being supremacy. I think we kind of dialogued about this earlier. I think the more apt description would be, you know, terrorism, white terrorism, white subjugation, domination, even in certain cases, mutilation. But I don't know if I agree with the word choice supremacy. But other than that, it's spot on.
Right on. And we will have time to chat about that as well throughout the course of the program. I guess before we get started with the specific incident of terrorism that you experienced and some of the background, I think it would be helpful. You have been an enforcement officer in Washington, D.C. Since 2010, even though you're on leave now. If you want to tell listeners anything about that experience, and I think importantly, why you wanted to be an enforcement officer in the nation's capital to begin with.
Well, quite a bit has happened. I'm actually not on leave. I'm injured. So I'm kind of considered an injured status right now. I'm actually, I returned to work a couple of weeks ago. But I chose to be a Washington, D.C. police officer because I live in Washington, D.C. I wanted to specifically have an impact on the young black males and young black females that I was actively engaged with. Prior to becoming a police officer, I, like everyone else, worked on the Hill, and I actually had a career as an analyst. That's pretty much what I did. I analyzed government contracts for a living. After being a little bit bored with that, I kind of wanted a change of pace. I wanted a change of lifestyle, so I decided to become, of all things, a police officer. I decided to, again, be a police officer in Washington, D.C., as opposed to Fairfax County or Montgomery County, because this is the community that I live in. So that was the primary motivation. Also, I've been familiar with some of the D.C. police officers with them. Community. Many of them kind of shared the same objectives that I did. They were, we were really trying to establish, in our minds, a form of justice. I knew that I could be necessary. I knew that I definitely would be different. I would say resume that most police officers came from. I came from a pretty academic setting, and I knew that my perspective could be useful. And so far it has been. Now, you also asked specific examples of racism that I've witnessed.
If you could think of some, that would be great as well.
I can. I can think of one instance in particular. I think I had a robbery. Well, I classified it as a robbery. White male caught in the act in the middle of Adams Morgan. Again, we had surveillance footage, pretty much everything. With one phone call, I believe his uncle was an ATF agent. I went to the precinct to, process him, handle all his paperwork. Next thing I knew, he was released, and I was receiving a detention journal. He got off completely scot-free, completely undermined the investigation that I had done, everything. It was a real slap in the face. That's just one example. Another example, we've had instances where there have been people didn't even allow you within their house to complete robbery reports or any reports, period. So just even though it's 2013, in this case, I guess when I was working, it was, 2012, these incidents still do happen in Washington, D.C., every day.
Not surprising. Thank you for the clarity and the specific examples that you have observed, which shouldn't surprise any non-white people. Yeah, any non-white people, I think Pam has said consistently, if a racist man, racist woman, racist child, if they are willing to lie and blame black people for things all the time, who's to say that they would not lie to help white people out so that they are not getting in trouble all the time. Great illustrations. For folks who might be listening in, I know we have folks who listen in from the D.C. area who might say, hey, D.C. area has a pretty high population of folks with a lot of melanin, lots of black people. If we're in a system of white supremacy and you're less confused about that, why join with the D.C. Police Enforcement Agency to begin with? You're just going to be helping white people maintain white supremacy. You're not going to be able to do anything to help yourself or other black people in the D.C. area. How would you respond?
I would say that Washington, D.C. is a bit of an anomaly amongst other police jurisdictions within the United States for some of the reasons that you mentioned. I mean, it is 66% black. And unlike other jurisdictions, you do have, even if they're figureheads, you have blacks at all levels. We're sergeants, lieutenants, detectives, assistant chiefs, chiefs in many cases. So the dynamic is a little bit different. I dare say that the incident that happened in Pittsburgh more than likely probably would not have happened to me within the Washington, D.C. area. And D.C. is unique because we are 36 jurisdictions within Washington, D.C. So there's a lot of, I would say, interplay, a lot of collaboration with other police jurisdictions, and all of them, you know, you're going to come across people who look like me, people who look like you and everyone else on the line. I mean, you have a good mix. It's, for all intents and purposes, diverse. And I hate to use that term, but it I would say that in many cases, my police jurisdiction reflects overall the demographics for the city that we live in. And I don't necessarily think that blacks with good intentions who are attempting to be effective police officers, and I know you don't like the term, but fair and just police officers, are supporting white supremacy by being, you know, in a very necessary place and by enacting a fairer system of justice. Police officers are given a lot of flexibility and they're given a lot of power. Generally, when there's a misuse of power or abuse of power, that's when the trouble or the problems occur. And I don't know, like I said, with my case specifically, like listening to that video clip, I actually wasn't familiar with the second part, but a big black man waving his baton. The funny thing is, and I know we'll get into this later, but I mean, I was injured, you know. That's the only reason I was even in Pittsburgh, kind of for that little short stint. And with that being said, we were talking about the fears that some people have just in terms of perceiving you. And I mean, I'm definitely a black male. There's no way of getting around it. While I'm not a fat guy, I'm a big guy. Like, I'm a pretty muscular dude. You know, and in contrast to the white officer who tasered me, who is several inches shorter than me and much smaller in stature, you know, I noticed that fear factor. There are some people whose first instinct is to pull a gun, to be afraid, and I argue that the most powerful tool that you have as a police officer is your mouth. And, you know, quelling the situation is completely and many times up to the officer. We have the ability to either bring it down and deflate it or inflate it. And there are a lot of people, a lot of officers that I've come across from all spectrums who are trying to work to that aim. They know that there are some serious issues in the justice system. They know that there are some serious issues with mistreatment of black people, and they're attempting to rectify it. And even though, you know, some people would say, you know, police officers are only figureheads, we're whatever it is we are, some of us are kind of working to that objective of, you know, achieving justice.
We will definitely get to the actual incident where the tasering occurred, but I think also relevant to this whole situation, just background as well, and further illustrate dangers of racism, white supremacy. You were injured at the time that you were tasered. You went into some of the details about how you were injured in your duties as an enforcement officer in D.C. Could you share some details with our listeners and how you observed white supremacy in operation at the time that you were harmed?
Well, very briefly, I think it was actually the day before my birthday, so on my sister's birthday, I got injured. I was responding to a fight, I along with my partners. We were responding to a fight when we were alerted by a group of people, black people, that a fight was about to occur between a white woman and a black male. And so we're attempting, I'm actually in between two people, I know, I'm actually in between two people breaking up a fight when people are pulling on me like, officer, these people are about to fight over there. And I mean, there was such a sense of urgency with these black people to break up this altercation, whatever it was, going off in the distance. But, you know, for the most part, when we're clubs or anything along those lines, we know that we have to be visible. We did what we did. We responded. And, you know, I went over there along with my partners, my four partners, and the individual that had the black male that had the altercation with the white female, he pushed my partner, a non-white female, in front of me. I was almost shocked when she attempted to stop him. So once that happened, obviously, he and I, you know, we had our little discourse, which ended up with me chasing him, him, you know, ultimately, like, flying into a brick wall and me ultimately snapping my ankle in four places. My partner, one of my partners was a black female. She also got injured. She was clotheslined by a black male's, I guess, friend or homie, succumbing to, I guess she had 8 or 9 staples in the back of her head. It was a bad night. But with regards to our treatment, even in the hospital, there were issues. The nurse that I had was acting as if she didn't want to be bothered. My mother, who's a nurse, obviously had a huge issue with this woman because this white female nurse was only a nurse for 1 year, and she wasn't really on the job. She almost acted as if she couldn't be bothered. And you have an injured police officer, you know, getting prepared for surgery, and she's oblivious doing whatever it is she's doing. And my partner, black female, pretty much went through the same thing. The surgeons and the doctors were phenomenal, but the nurses and the nursing staff, horrible. And it definitely was a correlation between age and, in many cases, race too, but definitely a correlation with age. The nurses that we had were much younger, and it showed. They didn't care. So from the hospital staff to I don't know, the disregard even for black life. Like, me and my partner, you know, we could have died. We could have died over something that sparked off as an altercation between, you know, these two people. And ultimately, the girl who, I guess, was assaulted or wasn't assaulted didn't even stick around to make a formal complaint. She ended up leaving before anything could happen. But nonetheless, that didn't stop me and my partner from succumbing to our injuries or having those injuries. So it's just kind of a tool of the trade, I dare say. I don't know. Like, it's difficult to gauge because most police officers would definitely say, at least in the capacity that I work in a club zone or something like that, you're kind of always outnumbered. But we do our best to look after each other because we realize on the street that we're all we have. And in situations like that, again, it forces you to definitely use your mouth and to use the powers of persuasion because you're attempting to deflate situations. You're attempting to bring it down. And in many cases, where applicable, you try to avoid arrests. Your main goal is not, you know, numbers, stats-driven, make arrest and, you know, I don't know, maintain the status quo, as some would argue. I hope I answered your question, but if I didn't, I'm sure you'll let me know. I'm not trying to speak around anything. Did I answer your question?
I believe so. I wanted to see, did you ever find out exactly the nature of the dispute between the black male and the white woman? Like, what was the problem? What have you?
I believe, well, she stated to my memory that he spit on her or something like that. It's unclear whether or not he spit on her because he was too close to her. It's unclear whether or not they even knew each other before this event. But just to show you, just, again, the absurdity of it all, we're breaking up a fight. I'm in the middle of breaking up a fight, a fist fight, and we are awarded with such urgency by these other people of that situation, which hasn't even become physical at that point. So it's just, you know, these are tools of the trade. These are things that you encounter on a day-to-day basis. I mean, it was a typical, I believe it was a Friday night, so there was nothing unusual about lots of, and I caution people about being drunk, but Adams Morgan, if you're familiar with Washington, D.C., is kind of known for that. In the summer, generally people congregate, get drunk, fight, and, you know, it's a general thing. And I don't know, after the injury and after my friend's injury, obviously my partner, we look at things a little bit differently. You can't place yourself in harm over nonsense. Not over a drunken woman word that may or may not be verified. There were so many things that I would do differently if I could. I have no qualms about, you know, stepping in and protecting my partner, because I know that, again, out there, my partners have always had my back and I have always had their backs. So that's just the way that that goes. But with regards to, I guess, the injury that I succumbed or that I, you know, endured, again, it did not have to be that way. I can be aggressive in terms of my policing style. I'm definitely a presence, but for the most part, again, I try to use my mouth to dispel the problems. So at this point, you know, an arrest wasn't even going to be made for this black man. We were just going to be like, yo, what are you doing? What happened? Go home. That was pretty much all it was going to be. So it went from being something really, really small, an altercation between two individuals, to, you know, I got him serving 3 months or 6 months, however much he served, and his friend getting 7 years for attempted murder of my partner, and deservedly so. Like, she almost died. It was major. She almost died, and I almost died. I mean, I'll take the ankle rolled in four places to death. And even with that, I had to come to peace with some things, because I had regard for his life even when he was going down. Like, when he was going down, again, my action, I diverted him away from that glass door towards that brick, because if he would have went through that glass door, I was directly, you know, after him on his tail. My aspaton, ironically, at the velocity that I was traveling, certainly would have cracked the glass, and it would have been a bloody situation. I was attempting to avoid that. I had regard for his life, and he had no regard for mine. And I know even that could only happen under the system that we discussed earlier, but these and many reasons more are kind of why I do the work that I do. It's necessary. Someone's got to do it.
Context of White Supremacy. Again, our guest, Mr. William Anderson III. I would again just point out to listeners, do not help white people. Do not help white people. Do not help white people. Big part of our grooming, brain trashing, particularly if it is a white woman, marshal all of the forces. Gotta support, help, defend, protect the white woman. Really try to work against that. They help. They got a whole system set up to take care of them. Very important background information for what happened in October with your situation in Pittsburgh, because you were injured at the time that all went down. If you want to kind of set us up with what was happening, what you were doing, boarding the bus, all that, what transpired between you and the bus officer, so we can get your view on what took place in Pittsburgh in October of 2012.
Absolutely. Okay, so very briefly, I was boarding the bus. I had just finished taking a statistics midterm, of all things. So I was boarding the bus. I had come from Washington, D.C. the day before. That's the only reason that I had my baton in my backpack. It was kind of like a thing, like, oh, I actually forgot it. I had submitted or turned in a lot of my equipment to my district, because after a certain amount of time passes, you have to turn everything in. And then, you know, everything is given back to you once your full duty status is recovered or given back to you. So I boarded a bus, and I observed a black male bus operator, completely nasty towards everyone, including, you know, others, mainly black people on this bus, and four whites too. But he was just nasty to everyone. His demeanor was horrible. So I boarded the bus, and I attempted to, I guess, grip one of the railings or something like that. I think I missed it when he started taking off, so my hand slipped. So my hand slipped and I almost fell. And again, I have a broken ankle, so I mean, I kind of was hobbling along. I was not in the best position. So my hand slipped, and I guess I came close to the bus driver, so he started cursing at me and started, you know, claiming that he was going to whip my behind and all this other different stuff. So once he did that, again, you placed me in defense mode. So just like that, I went into cop mode. Like, I know you're not dumb enough to seriously sit up here and threaten me and threaten to whip my ass, threaten to kill me, you know, in line of everything that's going on right now. But he was. So he continued to do this, and he motioned towards me. And at that point, I pulled out my ass baton, and, you know, I basically held my ground. I made a declaration, you're not going to harm me in any way, period. No threat was issued. I didn't say I'm going to whoop you upside your head, I'm going to beat you, nothing like that. I said, if you touch me, there's going to be consequences. And I think he kind of saw at that moment, and again, I should add this, I identified myself as a police officer before this happened, but not to the degree of what it was, you know, contextualized in the media. At no point did I ever say I deserve respect. No police officer talks like that. If that doesn't work on the street, why would I think that? If it doesn't work at work, why would I think that anywhere else? So anyway, this dude was very, very nasty, and I think he kind of saw, based upon my demeanor and based upon what he said to me, that he was not going to touch me. And if he was, like I said, that there was going to be consequences. So he notified Port Authority police. He didn't call Pittsburgh police because they probably would have done a more fair investigation. He contacted Pittsburgh Port Authority police. So the Pittsburgh Authority police officer, he arrived on scene. Again, and I'm standing away from the bus driver. I'm not swinging it mildly, and I should add that, you know, as someone that is skilled in the use of force, I definitely know, you know, the positions in which to maintain distance away from you, because my objective, even if I'm being threatened, is to protect my life but protect yours too. You always use the minimum amount of force necessary to execute the threat. I wish I could say the same for Officer Tipa of the Pittsburgh Port Authority Police, but he boarded the bus. I think one of the buses, I can't remember the specifics, but he boarded the bus. Again, my left hand, I had my ID out. He could see clearly that I was a police officer. He was like, you know, come with me, buddy, blah, 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 blah. And so he touched me on my right shoulder. So I'm like, I know this man didn't touch me on my right shoulder. But again, not being combative, not being anything, I just kind of complied. I get my backpack and I come off the bus. And that's when I'm tasered. I'm tasered on the third step. Again, my ID is on my left hand, clearly visible. And, you know, he tasers me. And then I think he tasered me again. Now, my right ankle is broken. Like, it's, you know, being recovered. It was broken, you know, a couple months before, so I'm still in recovery. So this individual uses some type of takedown force and, like, you know, drags me and does all of this other different stuff, and then has the audacity to say that I was resisting arrest, but that's fine. He dragged me into the scout car. He handcuffed my handcuffs way too hard, so much so, you know, that it was bleeding. And then I think when he actually did find out that I was a police officer, he kind of had a whoopsaw moment. I went through the process. I was released, I think, at 4:30 in that morning. He released, or Pittsburgh Port Authority released, you know, their concocted lie to the media, and that was that. Initially, I was going to respond, but as I hadn't had an attorney yet, I knew that, you know, it probably wouldn't be in my best bet to necessarily make any public statements yet. And I was still trying to mediate everything with my school. I didn't want there to be any issues or any bad blood. And again, I never made mention of the fact that I was a CMU student. I think that they've seen it. They've seen my ID when, I guess they were rummaging through everything. They ended up seeing it. But again, I should add that I'm going to say for public record again, I requested the ambulance and the board at least 30 times. Because when he tasered me on the right side of my body. I broke my right ankle. So once I got injured, I actually have metal rods in my foot. So he amplified the metal rods in my foot when he tasered me, you know, giving me an irregular heartbeat. I'm still dealing with now, and, you know, affecting the way that I walk, which I'm still dealing with now. But, again, the gumption, when we got to the police station, usually you try to come up with the most egregious charge. Nothing had been done. No investigation had been done, even though, you know, there was videotape. Surprisingly, you know, they couldn't find it. I mean, there was all type of helter-skelter, fly-by-night police activity. So my only caution to this police officer was that I hope you can articulate everything that you're doing. You better be able to articulate everything that you're doing in writing, because I'm not going to fight you on a physical. I mean, if we were in a different place, that's a different story. But I'm like, I'm not going to fight you on that level right now. What I need to do is hit you where it hurts on the paperwork trail. And I know you cannot justify tasering me because I complied. I complied. I had my badge out. Anyone knows that the kind of baton that I had, you can only get as a police officer. And if the so-called victim was cool, calm, and collected, then there wouldn't be any need for the actions that you took. Again, the mouth is the most powerful tool that you have to dispel anything. And I have been able to, again, and I've been in the middle of some very sticky situations where I've been able to retrieve guns, knives, and everything else just with my mouth. And that's least of all, you know, when I actually had and was justified in using any other types of force. But the number one tool that you have and you're always trained is your mouth. And this officer was unprofessional. He was unscrupulous and racist. Because I think the part that when I was getting tasered, he and I believe two of the other police officers called me boy. They may have called me buddy, nigger, and everything else. But I specifically recall boy. And I just kind of made a mental note of all of their names. And I was just making a mental statement for what I was going to write. And I tried to remember every possible detail. And then I tried to prepare what I was going to say to my job and what I was going to say to my school. Because, again, I was in Washington the day before. I only came back to take a test and, you know, to be with my family. So it was what it was. But, yeah, those are the actions that happened. I was released at 4:50 in the morning or 3:50 in the morning. They confiscated my car keys, so I didn't have any house keys to get into my house. So I actually had to break into my house. Fortunately, I had my wallet on me, so that information was, you know, I had my wallet, so I got a cab. But they held on to my properties over the weekend, continued to deny me my medication, and I think they had most of my medications. They had my medications, and then they attempted to even charge me with that. This particular racist terrorist specifically stated something along the lines of, well, you don't have your prescription on you, so I could technically charge you with that. And I told him, you can do what you can stand. Do whatever you can articulate. I was very clear. I was very succinct and to the point. I told him, as long as you can justify what you're doing, do it, by all means, because I'm going to justify my counter-reactions to everything that you're doing as well.
Gone. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I interrupt you?
No, I'm good. I'm sorry about that.
No apologies.
A little emotional topic.
I can understand. I just want to remind listeners, you can go back in the archives. Norm Stamper, former Seattle chief of police, white man, racist suspect, he was on the broadcast talking about his book, Breaking Rank, Norm Stamper, November 2009. This is on page 92 of the book. He's referencing the victim of white supremacy, Amadou Diallo, shot and killed. They fired over 40 shots at him, black male. Where he says, he's writing about Mr. Diallo, where he says 41 shots were fired, 19 of them striking Mr. Diallo. Diallo was not a rapist, cowbell. In fact, he had no criminal record. NYPD ruled it a clean shooting, meaning the killing of the 22-year-old non-English-speaking unarmed immigrant black male was legally justified and within department policy. The Department of Justice found no civil rights violations. A state criminal trial ended in 4 acquittals. But an innocent man was shot dead. Why? Because Mr. Diallo was black. I believe the cops were afraid of him for that reason, and that reason alone. So frightened, they couldn't see straight, think straight, shoot straight. If they'd been at their police department firearms range in the Bronx, all 41 of those shots fired as they were at point-blank range would have found their target. But why were they so frightened? President Clinton said at the time, if it had been a young white man in a young all-white neighborhood, it probably wouldn't have happened. To determine whether the Diallo killing or any other police action was racially motivated, you have to ask, would the cops have behaved the same way if the man had been white? No. Diallo was killed because of his dark skin. A white man reaching for his wallet under identical circumstances, including a language barrier, would have been given the benefit of the doubt. Simply put, white cops are afraid of black men. We don't talk about it. We pretend it doesn't exist. We claim colorblindness. We say white officers treat black men the same way they treat white men. But that is a lie. In fact, the bigger, the darker the black man, the greater the fear. The African American community knows this. Most whites know it. Thought that would provide context for what happened with Mr. Anderson. Now, I just want to go back to touch on a few of the points that were in the audio clip and the article to get your response, since they said that they made a point, I think, in the report of saying that it was a big guy and he was waving his baton wildly on the train. That's actually in the written article. I think they said it in the audio as well. So to that point, were you swinging your baton wildly and frightening other passengers on the bus?
Absolutely not. And in fact, if any of the people in Pittsburgh are listening to this, I mean, I urge you to contact Gus or be and provide the videotape surveillance footage that you encountered. That was not the actions at all. Most people were trying to plead with me. They were attempting to tell me that even though this dude was wrong, and that was specifically what was stated. Baby, I think that's what one of the older black women said. She was like, I know that this dude is wrong. He had no right to say what he said to you, but, you know, just let it go. And again, that's part of the programming that comes across by, you know, some of the regions or some of the places that you live in. I'm not used to kind of backing down when I see injustice. I'm someone that always fights for justice. That's just ingrained in me, and that's also part of the reason why, you know, I did the work that I did. And it's one thing if you disrespect me. A lot of times I can shrug it off because I really couldn't care less in any time. But when I'm injured, and in this case I was certainly injured, and you make it seem as though you're going to make good on your threat that you're going to kill me, you're going to whip my ass, you're going to murder me, you're going to do all of these things and all of these explanations, I'm just a nigger, and, you know, I'm a black bastard, and all this other, and you make it a point to say all those different things, understand that me, coming from the structure that I am, you know, as an officer, in a certain case, I guess, as a vice officer, understand that when people make threats like that, usually I have to respond, or it ends badly. So, you know, you can't just run off at the mouth and do anything and think that there's no consequences, and certainly not threaten people's life, but no, I was never wildly swinging the ass baton, and if that were the case, there were 40, 50 people on the bus. Why didn't they charge and lunge at me? If they were so afraid of his life, why didn't they step in? Why didn't someone say, hey, you're going to hurt him? Nothing was said. In fact, it was the contrary. People were like, yo, let it go. Just let it go. Because they're going to end up, I think a white guy said they're going to end up arresting you. I know that's impossible in my, you know, misguided thinking. I was like, I followed all the right procedures, all the right protocol, and I'm a police officer. And, you know, this dude threatened me. He threatened to kill me, like, in front of y'all. There's no way in the world that, you know, he's going to just get away with it. But I guess he attempted to. And, you know, the end result for what it will be, you know, we're being dragged out in court. But I just think it backfired in many respects on the Pittsburgh Port Authority police officer, because, good or bad, there is some truth to the blue line that some people speak of in terms of officers knowing what it is. Most of the true officers that read that story knew that was some nonsense. They just knew that it didn't add up, like, with what was released to the public. There were too many inconsistencies for it to be true. And my caution to that officer is, you know, when you bury another district under the bus, as he did, or as he attempted to do, you know, for sake of trying to clear your name, you're going to alienate yourself. Black officers that work for Pittsburgh Port Authority and Pittsburgh Police, they're going to know. They're going to remember my name. It's not going to be as clean cut as you think it is. That's one. And even white officers are going to distance themselves from you because nobody wants that headache. Fortunately for me, I'm not glad that it happened, but I am truly fearful for that particular officer because he doesn't, in my opinion, on what you just said, he doesn't be engaging or interacting with minorities, period. If you are so fearful that the first thing you do is pull out your taser and or your gun when someone has complied with you, when you're so arrogant and nasty, you don't know when someone's complied with you, you are not a prudent officer. And I can say that because I am a better officer than he will ever be, period.
Going further, a little bit further down in the report, where they say, witnesses say bus passengers were so concerned about their safety, they stood and cheered Port Authority police once they had the D.C. police officer in custody. Do you recall any outbursts of cheering and celebration when you were detained by the officers?
Absolute nonsense. Again, that was one of the many concocted lies that were told by Pittsburgh Port Authority, one, and that was ran by several of the unethical news mediums within the Pittsburgh area. And I should add, no one reached out to me for comment. I think my mother ended up contacting one of the newspapers because, again, their story was so off base. And my mother began to talk to them like, yo, my son is injured. You know, the extensive surgery that he went through, you know, for you and Grace is like, you know, what? And I think she came across a Pittsburgh police officer, someone from the Fraternal Order of Police, and they were a little bit more supportive to me than what I initially thought. They didn't necessarily say that this dude has a reputation, and I believe he does. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, I'm speaking about it now, I'm writing about it, because, again, I'm fearful for black officers, again, well, not young black officers, but young black people, possibly even young white people. This dude is, again, you cannot be a police officer and be operating under fear. It doesn't work. All you're going to do is, you know, be reaching for your gun with everything. And with every situation, a gun is not merited. Maybe 1.2 to 2% of all the situations that you're going to need is a gun necessary. And that's, you know, if you have a burglary in progress, you see a gun pointed at someone else, a gun is pointed at you, or, you know, there is a fleeing felon, there are three or four circumstances for which you are justified in taking lethal force. And when you're under a mindset of fear where you just are so afraid and so overcome by a big black man, you know, with the acetone, even though you left out the part that he had a huge ID, which is clearly visible, which states, you know, Metropolitan Police, it speaks volumes to your character. But to answer your question, no one was cheering loudly. There was no exclamation. Very rarely have I ever seen people cheer when any black person is being arrested, even when they were dead wrong. And in my circumstances, that was certainly not the case. It was certainly not the case at all. If anything, again, people were pleading with me. People were attempting to talk to me. They were like, I know that they said, I know that this dude is wrong, but you've got to let it go. But the bus driver sized me up as just another nigga. He didn't realize. And the police officer, you know, again, did the same sizing up. Oh, this is just another nigga, but this is a nigga with a baton. And if I hit this nigga, he might end my life. I don't know what he was thinking. but you know, it speaks volumes to his policing. And I should add that this was a canine officer, which adds, again, to the dynamic, because a canine officer generally has much less experience with people than they do with animals. And I should add, with his canine dog there, why didn't his canine dog attack me? Why wasn't the dog afraid? Why did the dog exercise more police action than the police officer? But again, I can't, you know, play Monday morning quarterback on their investigation or their non-investigation. Hello?
Oh, we can hear you. We can hear you.
I thought I'd hung up for some reason. But yeah, I can't. It's just, there's so many things. Again, I've moved beyond the frustration and the anger that I initially had because, again, my name was scandalized and none of it was true, and this was an instance where I was really cautioned not to speak out. And I had a million and one things going on. I had to deal with, you know, some penalties from my job. I was the victim in this situation, and I had to deal with, again, I'm being victimized and I'm being punished. So I had to deal with that. I had to deal with school. I still had to finish my, you know, semester. And it was a hell of a semester. You know, a graduate school is no joke, but a graduate school, you know, program at an engineering school is even more stressful because, again, I had nothing but science and math classes, or math and public policy classes, sorry. And because of court dates and, you know, the bureaucracy that was Pittsburgh Municipal Police, I had to continually miss class. I had to continually go to these meetings and only for them to be postponed. There was a lot of stress in addition to the physical ailment itself. My injury, obviously, everything was exacerbated. So I was in a lot of pain, an incredible amount of pain. And, you know, we pushed through. I had to pull through and kind of get it together, pull through that semester by any means necessary and just kind of, I don't know, invigorate my fighting spirit on a different level. I had to take to the pen and realize that the pen would be mightier than the sword in this instance, and just be grateful. I'm so grateful for the support that I have, and I should add, and I know some people may not feel me on this, but that's okay. I should add that my support has come from all spectrums. There have been so many people who have, you know, spoken to my character who have been like, no, that's some nonsense. I know Officer Anderson, and just knowing what I know, that doesn't even make sense. I've seen Officer Anderson have knives pulled on him and everything else and subdued, you know, the suspect with no euphor. I've seen him, you know, get into a middle of a sticky situation, potential robbery, a robbery or whatever, and manage to have no casualties. I even exercised discretion again when I was injured with the person that injured me. These are the kinds of things that speak to my character. So when you have your character assassinated by someone who, in your mind, number one, they're a lesser officer than you, but then on top of that, they're lying on you, it's a whole different dynamic altogether. But it shows you how strong you are. And, I mean, I'm not a Christian man. I've been with my ancestral worship, so I'm like, I thank the ancestors on everything because, you know, I went through this experience for something, and I hope everyone listening will take something away from it. I hope, you know, young black males in Pittsburgh, young black females in Pittsburgh, you know, will not be accosted. If anything, I know that, and I know you may disagree, but I'm like, I believe at least for a while, this officer will think twice. There's not going to be any more similar situations, at least from him. in the not too distant future. I think he's going to hold off. It's going to make him think twice. It's going to make the bus driver think twice. And if nothing else, you know, it's regrettable that I had to pay that price, but, you know, I do this for my future sons and daughters. That's how I have to chuck it up.
Context of White Supremacy. Give out the number, see if Justice has some questions. The number to dial is 760-569-7676. And the code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you have questions for Mr. Anderson. Number again, 760-569-7676. And the code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you have questions. Before I get to Justice, I will also make sure I let listeners know the title. I'm not encouraging, promoting black people, calling other black people niggers. I do not think that that is constructive, just to sit around and call other black people niggers, but the title was selected in an effort of revealing truth about the system of white supremacy. Unfortunately, the way the plantation is set up, you are not seen as upstanding citizen enforcement officer in our nation's capital, graduate student. All of that gets kicked to the curb. You are seen first and foremost as nigger, male, female, child. That is going to be number one, and then all the other stuff, maybe after we have designated you as nigger. I think that's very important. I think Mr. Anderson has been sharing quite a bit on that, and I think that's something that we should make sure not to forget or minimize, thinking that your title, that you somehow will not be seen as someone who should be mistreated, treated with discourtesy at all times, in all places. That's what racism, white supremacy is about. So that's why the title was selected. And again, not encouraging black people, calling other black people niggers, even with the definition being victim of racism, white supremacy, just putting it there for that point to serve as a mnemonic to remind us of what the problem is, what we should be focused on trying to correct. All right. With that said, Justice, if you have some questions for Mr. Anderson, your line should be open. Please feel free.
Greetings, Mr. Anderson.
Greetings.
I have a few questions to ask you. My first question is, why do you think the police tased you?
Oh, definitely fear. The police officer was more than likely very afraid of me. Even though I was compliant, I was not a threat. There was a significant, I should say, size difference between me and him. I guess 6 foot, 6 feet and a half, something like that. This officer might be about 5'2", 5'3". We may weigh the same because he's a pretty fat dude, but there was a significant height difference. So I guess, you know, when he seen me, he was afraid, even though I complied.
How did you feel when the taser touched you?
Oh, I mean, it hurt. I've been tased lightly, but it was painful. It paralyzes you. It's an awful feeling. And I think when I was paralyzed, I was still trying to show this idiot my badge, just to excuse the language, just in case he couldn't see it. I was like, my badge. My ID.
Wow, that's very unfortunate. Wow. Even though you are a police officer, did you think white people could still practice racism against you, arrest you at any time, and or do severe mistreatment?
I definitely think that they could cause severe mistreatment. I never thought that I'd be arrested only because, well, no, I'm not going to say that. I always knew there's a possibility that you could get arrested because I don't look like a typical police officer. I don't act like a typical police officer. Very rarely do I expose my badges. If anything, the joke is for most police officers sometimes that when we're not wearing our uniform, we look like S1, S2, that means any other suspect. I fit the criteria for 90% of the stuff that comes over the radio. Black male, you can choose your pick. Brown skin, dark skin, light skin, whatever. Between the height of 5'5" and 6'3". Between the ages of 20 and 34. So 85% of the stuff you fit. So, yeah, I mean, I knew that there was a possibility, but it was so remote in my mind. I didn't think that it certainly would happen there. More if I'm driving, you know, that could happen. I could be pulled over and someone could do something, you know, that could cause me significant harm. Or I always had a fear of doing undercover work. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, I'm here. Do you think if a white person was in the same situation that you were in, do you think that the white person would have got tased?
I don't think they would have gotten tased. No. I don't think they would have gotten tased.
Why not?
I think the fear element, for the most part, is just not there. If I am by proxy, and I'm not, I guess I'm not trying to single out, you know, shorter people or anything like that. It's no height benefits or anything like that. But if I am physically smaller than someone, if I have a weaker voice than someone, if someone, even if they're not speaking, has more presence than I do, I'm going to be afraid of that. So if there's a fear element, then, you know, and if that color element, and it does come into play, I am a dark-skinned black male or brown-skinned black male, whatever, certainly much more darker than he. It's just, it's a fear of a big black man. I see a big black man, you know, with a police, even though it's a police-issued baton. There is the potential that, you know, this ape could charge at me, this whatever could charge at me and cause me harm. And even if he doesn't cause me harm, him just existing is enough. It is so much of a fear for me that I am justified to shoot him, to tase him, to do whatever. And I'm so grateful to this day that I didn't have my gun on me. Mind you, I would have been justified to carry it. I would have been justified to have any of my weapons on me. I'm grateful that I didn't, because the story probably would have ended completely different. If they would have found that, then it would have been, you know, probably, you know, another police-involved shooting again. But, you know, fortunately that didn't happen. But yeah, I definitely think that there's a difference. I definitely think he was afraid. And I think that there's nothing that I can do, nothing that we can do that's going to change his fear at all.
If a situation like this happens again, how would you handle the situation better?
More than likely, I would walk away. I would not. I broke a vital rule. I generally do not engage in debate, arguments, or trifles or small things with people. So even when the dude threatened to kill me, and, you know, threatening to do all of this X, Y, and Z, I should have known in my heart of hearts, but at that moment I was very afraid. I would think differently. I would say, you know what, let me remove myself from this situation, you know, altogether. The only reason I should add that I even took the bus that day was because my leg was in so much pain. And I forgot my cane, so I'm like, maybe there's a possibility he didn't know, so maybe if I was ever hurt to that degree again, that I would bring my cane. I don't know. There are so many things that could have been different on all of our parts. But first and foremost, as soon as he talked to me nastily, I should have kind of gauged it as, you know what, I'm dealing with a victim or a fool or however, and I need to remove myself from the situation before it gets sticky. Yeah.
Wow. White people, I'm telling you. thank you for answering my questions. Gus, go ahead.
Context of white supremacy. I will give out the number one more time, see if any folks that are listening in, if y'all have questions, the number to dial 760-569-7676, and the code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you have questions. I will also remind listeners this sort of thing, unfortunately, is not an anomaly. Where a black enforcement officer ends up being abused and beaten by his own white so-called co-workers. Also reminded Dick Lair. We had him as a guest on the program back in December of 2009. He wrote the book, The Fence, A Police Cover-Up Along Boston's Racial Divide. He wrote this book published in 2009, but it's about Michael Cox, black male in Boston, Massachusetts. He was beaten savagely, left in a pool of his own blood, unconscious. They took him to the hospital, and after he began healing and was released from the hospital, he was trying to have an investigation as to what happened, why he was so savagely attacked, what happened, and you can check the program to get the details. You can check the book out as well. But Mr. Cox was making every effort to not make his beating about racism. He was distancing himself from other individuals who wanted to campaign about his case, who were talking about racism and saying there's no way this would have happened if it had been a white enforcement officer out. There's no way a pack of white cops are going to go and beat down another white officer this way and then try to cover it up after it happened. And the victim, Mr. Cox, he didn't want to do that. He just wanted truth. Acknowledge what happened. If punishment is deserved, that should be meted out in a just manner and to move forward. And his white co-workers continued to terrorize him. They vandalized his property and his home and picked on him. Because he was trying to investigate what happened to him. Really ugly incident. You can check out the broadcast, Dick Lair, the white author of the book, December 2009. But again, don't think that this sort of thing is, you know, strange or unique. This is the sort of thing that is supposed to happen under racism, white supremacy. I even remember worldwide this summer in the UK, there was a fire officer, black firefighter in the UK, who went to inform the UK police officers that something incorrect was happening. He was trying to notify them so they could go stop it. They ended up tasing and beating him, arresting him and taking him to jail. And he was trying to tell them the whole time, hey, I'm with you all. I'm a firefighter. And they snatched him and took him right to greater confinement, unfortunately. I wanted to ask, because when you were giving out some of the details, Mr. Anderson, about things that could have been done differently and how you normally don't even bother with, you know, petty arguments, particularly with other black people, as the bus driver in this case was a black person. Your incident in Pittsburgh happened very close to another incident on a bus where a black bus driver and a black passenger had major conflict and became major media attention. Can you kind of give some of your thoughts comparing and contrasting what happened in your situation with regards to what you saw in the Cleveland situation?
Well, it's funny, as we discussed earlier, everyone thought that I was involved in that. But you're referring to the incident that happened between the bus driver and the black female, and the bus driver ultimately punching the black female in the, well, uppercutting her. It's being an officer, We deal a lot with Metro Transit, so I'm like, I definitely feel for a lot of what the bus drivers have to deal with, because, you know, you do have unruly passengers, and there are threats sometimes to your life, but at the same time, again, you have to be ever mindful of how you talk to people and how you carry yourself. Generally, as it relates to most dealings with people, it's not even what you say so much as how you say it. Just knowing what I know and looking at it from the outside, there are a million ways in which that situation could have been prevented. But we, as black people also, we have to kind of get out of the spectacle. Like, there were some people who thoroughly enjoyed that, like watching that. They liked seeing, you know, this punishment, this ensuing between black male and black female. And again, I caution us to stop being spectators. We have to stop participating in the shenanigans and the nonsense. We have very important work to do. Others, and this is where it relates to other people getting involved. I've been that person, and this is partly us being a Washington, D.C. officer. Sometimes I have intervened, a lot of times off work, you know, in the district that I live in, which is, you know, kind of plagued by crime and everything else. It's the Marshall Heights area of Washington, D.C. We have to check each other's behavior. When it's incorrect, you have to step in and let them know this is incorrect behavior. You cannot be afraid. And there are consequences for that sometimes, but, you know, these are, again, it's going to take a village. that bus, if there were many participants and everything else on that thing, people should have stepped in. Someone should have been like, yo, this is in our hands. Sister, come with me. Pulled her away, pulled him away, made a call. There are a million ways in which that situation could have been handled differently, in my humble opinion.
I know when we talked before the broadcast, you were saying that these incidents happen so close in proximity that some of your relatives, friends, family members, they thought that the Cleveland incident that was getting so much media attention, they thought that was you. Is that true?
Right. Some people did. So a lot of people did. They were like, oh, man, you know, you beat up the bus driver. X, Y, and Z happened. They were like, you were all over the news. And I was like, I am not that guy. Clearly, I'm not 61. I was in Pittsburgh, not in Cleveland. There were some similarities. I mean, there was a lot of confusion, and I think even part of that is by design. We definitely need different news and media outlets to get this story straight. But yeah, a lot of people thought it was me, or at least I was involved. And yeah, I'm not that guy. I didn't uppercut a woman. I didn't uppercut a bus driver. No violence was used. Nothing along those lines. But yeah, it was funny. Everyone thought I was that guy in Cleveland, and then I became, you know, the guy on CBS Local. So I don't know which is worse.
Neither is that good, I would say, under racism, white supremacy. I guess one thing I would say, definitely the Cleveland situation, not involving our guest, Mr. William Anderson III, the Cleveland situation, as I said, pathetic, embarrassing display. I mean, yeah, the physical violence against black females, really something we should be taking note of and working to eliminate as soon as possible, and really getting the word around that that just is not acceptable under any circumstances. Really pitiful. But as you said, with this situation happening, I think a couple days or maybe even a day or so after your incident in Pittsburgh, when I saw the Cleveland situation, and I didn't find out about your situation until later on, but when I saw the Cleveland situation, I said on Facebook the same thing that I just said, very pathetic, very embarrassing, particularly an embarrassing commentary on black masculinity 2012. But I did not have that much of a response because I said this sort of thing happens every day with regards right. to black people being thrown off of a bus or out of a building, even if it's just black people, even if there are no white people directly involved. This this is the plantation, folks. I mean, you know, I didn't even, I still am having a hard time, other than, I guess, just the spectacle of it all and people getting a kick out of it. But even with that, I'm aware that there are a lot of websites that just, that's all they have is video footage of people fighting, any of them black people, fighting, whether it's black males fighting other black males, black females and black females, black males and black females. As you were saying, this is, it's kind of become a thing that people enjoy, going to different websites. I don't want to give names, but going to different websites and getting their popcorn and watching this sort of thing, enjoying and rooting it on and that sort of thing. I guess with in terms of, you already said it, number one, you would make an effort to just walk away. So that's one of the big things that maybe could have de-escalated the situation, even though the black bus driver was being rude to you and discourteous, just kind of letting it go. That's one thing that you could have done differently. Is there anything else you can think of that maybe could have produced a better outcome for everyone involved?
I should have been truthful. I should have more clearly identified, and I should have been like, you know what? I realize that you're a victim, and I realize that there are, I'd be completely justified right now in doing X, Y, and Z, possibly even in taking physical action, but you know what? It's not worth it. You've wronged me. Maybe I could have said nothing at all, but I said, you know, you wronged me. This is not the proper way in which you handle business, and that could have been the end of it. I could have taken his information and written a letter and, you know, going through them to get him in trouble and all that other stuff, but at the end of the day, we as public servants, we have to check our abilities. Check our attitudes. Everyone has bad days. There have been times when I had bad days, but you know what? When I got that call for assault with intent to rob, or, you know, armed robbery or whatever, all of my attitude goes out the window. I know that I have a duty to protect citizens. I have a duty to protect myself. And if I don't respond to the given situation in a cool, calm, collected manner, that's generally how I behave, there's going to be an unfavorable outcome for us all. With him, I should have been more forgiving. I should have been like, you know what, you don't even realize what you're saying, and you don't really intend to kill me. But at the same time, I don't like putting all the pressure on me, and I know that we do that. We have a tendency to do that when we're trying to be, you know, righteous men and righteous women. But at the same time, you also have to know what you're dealing with. If someone is not in a place to receive or to know your righteousness or your unrighteousness, then you have to remove yourself. You have to remove yourself for your safety and for theirs. So, I don't know, say something, not say something, drive. Instead, I should have just driven instead of taking the bus. As far as my conduct with the police officer, I don't think I really could have done anything differently. I wasn't combative, despite whatever, you know, said. And I know the difference between being combative and being non-combative. And in order for him to justify me being combative, at some point I would have had to use trigger words that caused or, you know, directly implied injury to him. And at no point were any of those words stated. And again, I have to do this for a living. So I have to remember in specific detail what I say, because if I don't remember it as it happened, again, when I'm on that stand testifying, that defense attorney will hem me up. So, I don't know, so many things could have been done differently as far as our treatment towards each other. But he is a black man. He did recognize me as an officer, but he should have exercised a lot more respect, especially once he knew that I was injured. And maybe I should have said what the newspaper said. I should have said I deserve respect. I would never say that, because I don't believe someone can give me anything. I just believe you can show me respect, and I can show you respect in return. But you just got to know your audience. And I don't know, maybe I should have been wiser and realizing that, you know what, this individual may want a spectacle. You know what, these police officers may want a spectacle. These people sitting on the bus may want a spectacle, but I'm not their team sport. I'm not their mascot. I don't dance around, and I don't, you know, I don't do fire dances, so sorry, not that guy.
Would you, I guess with hindsight, if you had it to do over or were presented with a similar situation, would you brandish your baton, or would you keep that in your backpack or keep it, you know, I don't know, whatever, wherever it would normally be when it's not in use?
I think no, because like I said, I would hope that it wouldn't come to that, because I know if I pull out my ass baton, that I will only use the ass baton if you are going to cause me immediate danger. If you hop out of your seat and you lunge towards me, or if I think that you're going to lunge towards me, it becomes a little bit more difficult, because in the middle of that guessing game, if I think a hand is going to fly towards me, my instinct is going to be to react and to respond. And, you know, that's just, I think it was safer in certain respects that I pulled out the ass baton as well as the ID, because that kind of made me identify myself as a police officer, and it made me follow protocol straight to firm. I didn't forget where I was, I didn't forget who I was, forget my duties, and even with all of that, I still had a certain regard for his life that he didn't exercise for mine. Now, granted, you know, he may be being Floyd, and a lot of the statements based upon what, you know, was stated in court, I knew he wouldn't have written, because it was written in the manner that a police officer writes. So I know that a lot of it was concocted by Richard DePippa. But, again, people, I know he's going through his own trial, because he knows he was that wrong, and he knows who the clear victim was, and as I said, his guilt will take care of him. He is the least of my concerns. For the police officer, like I said, even he is kind of a non-factor at this point, because I'm one of those people to where, like, I'm going to use this to my advantage, not on anything, you know, crazy, but just on some, I'm going to use it to fuel me to be a better officer, to be a better attorney, to do whatever it is that I set out to do and to make sure that this doesn't happen. And so, no, I wouldn't have not brandished the ass baton, because the fact remains someone still threatened to kill me. And when you're unpredictable and when you make statements to an officer like, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to cause you harm, I'm going to whoop your behind, I'm going to do X, Y, and Z, I'm going to do any of those things, you have a responsibility to protect yourself. And again, I'm not someone that, officers by nature are not, well, many of us are not by nature offensive, we're reactionary. Now, I am an initiator, but that's on a different level, not an initiator when it comes to physical actions like responding to someone. I'm not going to protect myself unless you cause me harm. And, you know, like, I would never, my objective is always to make sure that all of us, if possible, make it home, you know, at night. Again, I had a right to arrest this man. If I had my handcuffs, technically I could have made my arrest. I could have made an arrest and it would have been justified. They would have been angry, and they would have been kicking and screaming, because Pittsburgh Port Authority would have been like, well, it happened on our bus. But at the end of the day, my jurisdiction as a Washington, D.C. police officer is federal. So that case would have been rolled right over to Pittsburgh Police, and Pittsburgh Police would have been like, go ahead, take it, it's yours. But I even exercised discretion in that. I didn't want any of that. All I wanted to do at that moment when this individual, you know, was perceived as a threat to me, and when they stated that they were going to cause me harm, that I was going to protect myself. And the only time that I was unable to protect myself in my entire career, I ended up almost dying. My partner ended up almost dying. And I was not going through those odds again. There was not going to be another surgery. There was not going to be another anything. And I should add that a lot of this fell on me. Even when I had the surgery, like, my family, you know, were not in Washington, D.C. They were in New Jersey, so I had to take care of everything. I had to heal myself. I had to take care of a lot of things on my own. And remembering that, I wasn't trying to go through that again. And even with all that they did to me, I would still not wish that on them just because it was a hellish experience. And again, I'm guessing or I'm hoping that this speaks more to my healing process and more to my character than theirs. Sorry for going around the thought. I usually keep it very specific. I don't know why I gave such a long answer.
Context of White Supremacy. The person who dialed in, 7344, if you had a question for Mr. William Anderson III, your line should be open, 7344.
Thank you, Matt. May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
I came in a little late on the call. I just wanted, one of the questions I want to ask the caller is, how long was he an enforcement official?
I'm still not an enforcement official, so 3 years.
Okay. Your incident happened in, what city was that?
Pittsburgh.
Do you have, peace officer status in, Pittsburgh?
I do because I'm a Washington, D.C. is not a state. We're a federal jurisdiction. So Okay. Our jurisdiction is the only jurisdiction that, in most cases, is federal because of the reason that we just stated. We're not a state. So our jurisdiction typically carries everywhere. Now, every police station may not necessarily know that, but generally once they do the paperwork and they're like, oh, Congress, you know this particular amendment establishes police officers within Washington, D.C. federal jurisdiction. Now, it's unclear whether or not they knew that, but it doesn't change my jurisdiction.
Yeah, the reason I ask that question is because I'm a retired enforcement officer, and I worked out of New York City, and I know that one of the things that, you know, as an enforcement officer, we always have liability issues. You know, that was one of those things that was ingrained, you know, the liability to make sure that you was within the scope of, you know, your job description or whether or not you was in your geographical area of employment, and that, so having that in mind, in addition to being a black male, I knew that I would more than likely not get the benefit of the doubt unless everything was, you know, in order. And even that would be difficult to have because, you know, you would have to have witnesses supporting you, and you know, you made efforts to restrain where, you know, people heard you make verbal commands. So that's why I was asking that, because I know that becomes very problematic even on a federal level when you're in another jurisdiction, as you said, might not even recognize that you have any police powers. So, as a result of this particular, and I know Gus had asked you whether or not, you know, you learned, would you do anything differently, but have you learned anything as a result of all of this that happened?
Absolutely. I learned, how it relates to my treatment because of not getting the benefit of the doubt, even as a D.C. officer, because of the black man. I learned, intrinsically, I think West D.C. has to share this racial. It's not to say that D.C. is above it all, but there's some definite differences between how Pennsylvania sounds, the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, especially Western PA, with where I'm from. And I also learned that I have to get less involved. People disrespect people. Maybe I should follow Nimi Fuller's rule. If I'm not willing to take everyone out, I have to step back because at the end of the day, when it all goes down, very few people are going to jump to back me in the magnitude that I have with them. And that's just one, some of the many things that I've learned in this this experience. But to piggyback on a point, I actually gave loud verbal commands. I actually had my ID out the whole time. I stated it over and over and over and over again. For the record, I made sure that I was loud enough so that the audio file could hear it. I am police officer, blah, 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 CAD, X, Y, and Z. You have just threatened. I tried to keep it as, you know, professional and as to form and script as I possibly could for those reasons. But I have learned, even when you follow it, you know, straight to form protocol, everything else, you have to be, it's just not the same. It's always going to be different.
I agree, and just, you know, and I'm not going to take up any more time, but I realize in my experience being, I was, you know, fortunate enough to retire, but I did learn that as a black male officer, especially in New York City Police Department, you didn't get the benefit of the doubt. If you was in plain clothes, the likelihood of you even be working, or plain clothes when you wasn't in uniform, if you was working, you could, you know, have been killed. It happened. It was several incidents that happened while I was during my tenure, where, you know, black enforcement officials that were in soft clothes, plain clothes, were shot by other you know, officers. So I guess just to say, you know, you seem like you had you're relatively new in your career, and you're definitely gonna have to follow the advice that Neely Fuller said. And if you can, if you're not working and you're in another jurisdiction, you know, definitely take two steps back, and if you want, and, you know, call the local enforcement officials at that area. So I'll mute my line. Thank you, Gus.
Excellent point.
Thank you. Appreciate the information. What are your thoughts on that? I know Mr. Fuller has been pretty stern about that, pretty consistent in saying with regards to counter-violence at any time. I think he's normally talking about a firearm, but baton, weapon of any sort, and saying if you, once you are wielding a weapon, you're displaying it for other people in some sort of conflict, you should be prepared to kill everybody present and to die yourself. That's what you should be prepared for, total war, once a weapon has been pulled out. And if you're not willing to go that far, then, you know, you should be looking for other alternatives to resolving the conflict, something that does not involve a weapon. What do you think about that, given the hindsight of your situation?
I agree. I think even besides, you know, killing, I just mean in terms of protecting, I would not go through extreme lengths unless I'm dealing with children. Children, I'll tend to protect those, or maybe elderly, those who completely cannot protect themselves. I mean, like, there's no other alternative but to, you know, use an ass baton or whatever else is, you know, at hand. But I mean, I agree with a lot of it. You have to be cautious, and you have to not get involved. So much of young officers, I would say those who have less than 10 years or 7 years experience, many of us do want to be super cops. We do want to save the world. We have this idealism, and we're like, you know, a crime has been committed. Boom, you know, respond, super cops. a lot of black officers typically know, we know that the badge doesn't really mean as much as it doesn't mean much to people. And that's why a lot of times, like I said, I am very reluctant to even let that be known. And I come from a law enforcement family. Like, you know, both of my uncles were sergeants, retired out of Newark. My sister is in some way affiliated with law enforcement, military in my family. So it's like I should have known better in certain respects. I'm not a brilliant guy, but I'm smart enough to know how I should have been smart enough to know how that situation was going to pan out, even if I did all the right things, and even if I was protecting myself, even if I was protecting him. I'm happy, though, that no violent action was taken. I'm happy that I didn't utilize my weapon, cause anyone injury. Even in the protection of myself, I'm happy I did comply. I'm happy I had my ID out. But yeah, you've got to take a step back if you're going to make it home, because every battle is not meant for you to fight, in your jurisdiction or not. And I do think that had I contacted Pittsburgh police, the situation would have been a little bit different, because Pittsburgh police, from my understanding, have a little bit more of an understanding than a Pittsburgh transit cop. They just don't, especially a canine cop. They don't have the same understanding. They don't do the same things. Our realms are two different spheres. But, I mean, there's still, obviously, there's some things that I have to learn. painful way to learn it. Hopefully I'll look for, you know, more constructive, less painful solutions to problems in the future. And hopefully, you know, I won't have to deal with this again. I'm confident that I won't have to deal with a situation like this again. My instruction is to just hope that anyone who is an officer, who is being victimized, who is being threatened, just remember all the facts, figures, circumstances. Just remember all the paperwork. Just remember all the I's and the T's. And then remember that you're probably not going to win. And take a step back and save yourself. Because, you know, and that was the part that kind of hurt. One of the people who I did come across in this ordeal was a black lieutenant in Pittsburgh, Port Authority. And he was the one who, I'm not going to say he mistreated me as much as the officer did, but, I mean, they were neck and neck. He was talking about, you know, I didn't have this authority and blah, 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 and, you know, all the reasons why, you know, again, the ambulance couldn't come yet, and the officer had to finish his thing, and he stood by his officer. And, again, my advice to him, my statement to him, just like I stated to the officer, I hope you can articulate everything you're doing. That's it. Because I have requested ambulance. I've requested X, Y, and Z. You continue to deny them on no basis. So you know what? Whether you choose to accept it or not, like, I am an officer. My job is going to, you know, complete an investigation. And just as I'm going to be investigated, so are you. And if they're looking for a scapegoat, just as, you know, many are going to try to pin it on me, the black male officer, what do you think they're going to do if the ish hits the fan? Do you really not think that the black lieutenant, the so-called senior official on staff, isn't going to take the heat? So you might want to think twice, too. Just saying.
Caller in Brooklyn, if you had a question for Mr. Anderson, your line should be open.
Greetings. Have you heard?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, Gus, Justice, and the guests.
How you doing?
Not bad. Been better. Been worse. Very interesting topic tonight. I kind of wasn't going to ask anything at first. I kind of feel like, I don't know. I wouldn't know what to ask. You know, I just feel like it's kind of, we're all kind of a bunch of fishes, victimized fishes swimming around in victimization here on planet Earth, you know, as black people. But, I guess this comment about, Neely Fuller's suggestion that, you know, if as a victim of white supremacy, if you pull out a weapon, you should be ready to kill everybody. I guess all the, you know, kill everybody present and yourself, or the suspected racist, you know, because we're really not in a position to truly defend ourselves as in the system as it is. So I guess I don't know, like what do you I mean, did you have some type of experience as a police enforcement official? Did you like realize at some point that, wow, we're in a system of white supremacy? You know, like, did you have at some point kind of realize that, like, after you, you know, decided to become a enforcement official?
No, I knew we were in a system before I became a police officer. I think that's part of the reason why I became a police officer. I wanted to give at least a more equal balance. When 75% of the crime, or so-called 75% of the crime, or 90% of the lookouts for suspects are, you know, black, and I guess increasingly in D.C. Hispanic, you know, what does that say when we're not even a majority anymore in Washington, D.C., or a bare majority? And I kind of knew that we are feared. There is something, I don't know what it is, to a lot of even increasingly some black people are afraid. It's a fear of a young black male. And because I have been that young black male, and I mean, you know, fortunately through guidance, through will and everything else, I mean, I've been, prior to this, and I think after this, you know, relatively successful. But I think anyone knows that we are definitely in a system. Racism is strong. I mean, it's not going anywhere. It's something that I think I've studied it. I'm not going to say extensively, but I've studied it since I was young. I mean, I understood that there's a fear of black men.
If you say there's a fear, so then I feel like, I mean, you're kind of focusing on the feelings of the people that are carrying out the, you know, this crime against us. So, I mean, it's like, it's almost like trying to rehab, if you're saying that we are feared, it's like you're focusing on the feelings of the people who aren't really, you know, acting with humanity. You know, I'd like to say that they were afraid of you, and that's why they tased you, giving you irregular heart rhythms, could have potentially killed you, you know, and to say that that's out of fear. I mean, isn't it?
I'm sorry.
I don't know. I just feel like it'd be more accurate to say that they're terrorists than to say that they're afraid. It's like,
but even parts of terrorism utilizes fear. Terrorism is a tiered system. And to be fair, I'm not, and I know you hate that word, but I'm like, I am not cutting them any slack for my mistreatment. But again, and I stated in the very beginning, the reason why I became an officer was to reach out to my community, was to help out the people in my community and to give a much better representation of officers, and to keep these young brothers out of the streets, one, and from killing themselves, and from killing each other. So I wasn't attempting to rehab DePippa. Like I said, I don't think that there's anything that I can do that's going to rehab a terrorist. But because I realize that it's beyond my control, all I can do is kind of play my part in it. I'm beyond him. I'm not, I mean, it's unfortunate, and I do not accept what's happened, and I'm going to fight smartly to challenge it and to channel my energies in a constructive manner. I can't be ruled by emotionalism right now. If I get angry, and if I get afraid, and if I get bogged down, and if I get caught up, then I'm off my task. And my task is to make sure that I am saved, protected as much as I can be in a given system, but to also make sure that those who can't be, have. Like, it doesn't mean much to them. I mean, obviously, it doesn't mean anything to them. But when I came home to my community, and again, people heard about the story, and the young boys that I mentor, again, they knew that it was some nonsense, and they came to me, and they thanked me, and I got love again. It made me realize why I did the work that I did, because I live in Washington, D.C. I live in Northeast Washington, D.C. Unlike some, and I'm not going to say, you know, I'm not going to criticize those who don't live in D.C., but I live in the same community that I work in. So a lot of the people who I arrest, guess what? I run into them at the grocery store, at the car wash, at the where we are everywhere. We have interactions at almost every facet. And if I don't run into them, I run into their children. And because I have treated them with a certain level of humanity, because I've never infringed on them, because I've never, you know, emasculated them, you know, told them they were nothing, tasered them, shot them, brutalized them, subjected them to the violence that I have been subjected to, my street cred speaks for itself. I have their respect. So even if I don't have, you know, Pittsburgh Port Authority's respect, it doesn't matter, because there are those whom are watching what I do, and hopefully we can become better men because of it.
I was making a comment. I just having people walking around with guns. I'm not trying to judge you. I feel for you as a victim, but my thing is that I don't really see how we can like affect change walking around with like guns, like. But I guess we're all doing our part to keep white supremacy going, so I can't really point at anybody. But, yeah, sorry that happened to you.
It happens. I'm not going to say it happens. But, I mean, you're entitled to, and I respect your opinion. I'm like, my goal is to learn. But I felt very similar to you. I had my issues before I became a police officer. I was like, oh, man, you know. Black police officers are the most crooked. We're the ones, you know, who do X, Y, and Z. And, again, when I made the transition, everyone looked at me like I was crazy. They were like, you know, you turned down a PhD at Stanford to be, you know, a cop? Like, what the hell are you thinking? Like, you know, where is your mind? But I knew, at least for the time being, that these young brothers and these young sisters, they needed me, and I could, at the time, fill a void. But what I begin to see, like we all begin to see, is, again, when systems are operating within systems, you know, one person, they're going to execute a certain amount of change, but actually, yeah, they'll execute a certain amount of change, but you have to gauge what difference that makes, whether it's worth it. And, again, I think if you saw the officers that I saw, and maybe if you knew me, you'd be like, okay, you know, this person is in the community, they're mentoring, they're doing what they're doing, they're actively participating, and they have a profound love for their people and for themselves, and they're trying to carry themselves in a certain manner, and they're trying to be an exemplary example. I think your position on law enforcement would change, but I don't know. I mean, you seem adamant in your conviction, so all I can say to that is, you know, I don't know. I don't know. I appreciate your comment, and I hope that I'm able to learn from it, and I hope that, I don't know, you take something constructive away from whatever it is that I'm saying or not saying tonight. Hope it resonates in a positive way.
I definitely got, you know, I got a lot from the interview, and I appreciate you coming on, and, you know, I hope things go better for you.
Thank you.
Thanks for the commentary, caller in Brooklyn. Non-Mightywick, if you had a question for Mr. Anderson, your line should be open.
Good evening. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I just wanted to know, just in your experience, just how common is it for a black enforcement official to either have shot or tased white people? And the other gentleman who said he was an enforcement official too, if he's still listening, if he gets a chance to comment on that too, I'm just curious.
Ironically, I am a stats man, and that's been something that I've been trying to investigate for the longest time. I don't know the numbers, but I see very little evidence, if it even happened, where a black enforcement official has tasered a white individual without there being severe repercussions. But I don't have any numbers, any hardcore data. I just have my opinion on it as it relates right now, and I find that highly unlikely. I'm not going to say heads would roll, but there'd be media coverage. There'd be a lot of things if that happened. It just does not happen, at least in the same magnitude, certainly as it happens to a white enforcement official tasering and or illegally killing a non-white.
I guess I'm saying, so, like, you've been an enforcement official, say, about 2-3 years. Have you ever heard of a black enforcement official shooting a white person at all? Are you saying that's never occurred? I mean, even legally, have you heard that happening at all or no?
I have never heard of it happening. That's not to say it doesn't exist, but I'm like, I have never heard of it. I've never heard of it.
Okay. And what about tasing?
Yeah. Tasering, a little bit more frequently, but I'm trying to remember. There's a case in Virginia, but I don't remember if the enforcement official was black. I want to say it happened in the Hampton Roads area. I would have to research it. But tasering less so, because many jurisdictions don't allow tasering for the reasons that we discussed earlier. Like, sometimes if you have a heart, something wrong with your heart or defibrillator, whatever the issue is, it can get severely thrown off with tasering, so a lot of jurisdictions have gotten away from tasering. So that data might be even harder to find, but yeah, based upon your initial question, I find that highly unlikely. highly unlikely.
Okay.
Can I be heard?
Yes, I can hear you.
Well, in my experience, the tasers was relatively new device that we used. So we had nightsticks and pepper spray. And there have been times when you would, pepper spray a white person. But that doesn't have the similar effects that a taser does. And as far as in my experience in my 20 plus years, I had not witnessed any black enforcement officers legally, if that would be correct, shooting a white person.
Thank you.
You're welcome. May I ask a question, Gus?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Anderson, is that what it is?
Hey, Brian. Yes, sir.
Okay, pardon me. Another thing I could suggest to maybe make the transition a little easier. It's not going to be easy in the system of racism, white supremacy, because, especially when you're working with enforcement officials, in my experience, that's what they do. They look forward to doing it. I learned, later in my career that there was really no only time when they had the so-called blue wall that was only for you supporting them and their terrorist acts. That's the only time it was a blue wall, or when they did something as, terrorist acts. My experience, we always have been the first ones to go. And when they had time to meet, any type of administrative action, you would, get it, lose your job or whatever. But the only thing I would suggest to you is to make the transition a little simpler. It's not going to be easier. Or, I would say, definitely take whatever promotion exams that are available to you. Being on the street, I know you mentioned about having street cred, which is, that's nice, but that's not going to stop them when they want to come after you for doing whatever it is that you want to do. So what I could suggest is just, definitely, if you're going to be there and you're going to try to make a career out of it, then definitely do it from a level as a supervisor.
And then
I'm you on line.
I agree. And I thank you for that. With as far as the future goes, everything is kind of up in the air at this point. I'd love the work that I did, and I still do. you look at it a little bit differently after an event like this happens. Some things are shaken, and some things are confirmed. It's the tightrope, it's the balancing act. It's, again, you learn. But when I was saying street cred, I didn't mean in terms of, I was talking about in terms of having the respect of the people that I work with, just in terms of how I handle people. I was reminded in a recent conversation with my sister that just because, you know, you go about things in a righteous manner, that doesn't necessarily mean that everyone else does. And it's not to say that I'm holier than thou or that I haven't made mistakes, because I've made mistakes and I'm going to continue to make mistakes. But I try to be as accurate as I can be, because, again, and I looked at it from this manner before and I looked at it in this manner now, it could be me. That suspect very well, you know, could be you. And I think most non-whites can kind of see that dynamic more readily than whites can. But that doesn't even necessarily mean that some whites can't. But I just think it's more apparent or maybe it's just more apparent for me. Maybe this experience just made it that clear. I don't know. I'm learning.
May I ask a question again? I apologize.
No, go ahead.
Oh, yeah.
In D.C., what is the demographic as far as the force in itself? Is it more non-white officers, or is it more white officers? What's the breakdown?
Okay, so the most recent demographic said that it's 66% black. Our current chief is white, but before her, we had Chief Ramsey, who was black, and I think before him, we had a couple black chiefs. So the police force overall is black. Now, where it gets sticky is by districts. There are 7 districts, first district, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh, so on down the line. I would say that the second district, the first district, and to a degree the third district are less black than the other ones, and that corresponds to wealth too. Second being the wealthiest. I don't know if you know about D.C., but like Georgetown and stuff like that, all of those areas fall in the second district. But, 66% black. I can't remember we have a large number. I think it's like almost 25% women, and then 75% men. It might be 30%, but those are the most recent demographics. But with everyone retiring a couple years, I'm pretty sure that's going to change. And with the requirements being different now with, X amount of college credits or college degrees, I'm sure that the demographics are going to change.
Okay, I find that interesting, because when I was in New York City, statistically, more non-white people had college degrees or college credits than the white enforcement officials. And I also noticed that when it came to enforcement, there was always a greater area of enforcement in non-white areas than it was in the so-called well affluent white areas.
True. The interesting side note with D.C., though, that makes it a little bit different, I think the loophole or the way in which you get around that is military service. And, you know, in Washington, it's not hard to find someone with military experience. So I think it's 60 college credits, or a degree, or you have military experience. But yeah, I've seen there have been a lot of, I don't know, I would say overall, younger officers, typically those with less than 7 years on, typically have degrees and are degreed and military experience. So it's like, it's not, I don't know, New York is just different for a whole number of reasons. NYPD is just, you know, they're unique. It's unique in its own set. D.C., the demographics, like I said, right now, they're currently, it's overall black, but things are going to change if they're not already changing, because D.C. itself is changing and the requirements are becoming more and more stringent, because as far as local jurisdictions go, D.C. is appealing to many people, especially those with military service. So once someone gets out of their stint with the Army, the Navy, the whatever, you know, they come almost in droves to become a police officer here.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
I was wondering, I've got my personal experience with enforcement officials, and everyone, you know, else does, whatever. But what previous to becoming a enforcement official, I don't know, maybe a enforcement official in your family, but what was your experience, your relationship to enforcement officials before becoming a part of that group?
Well, it's two-tiered. I mean, I'm just going to be honest. Like, I do have law enforcement family in my family, but at the same time, I mean, I hate saying this, but my mother's children, we were kind of the only ones to never be arrested and incarcerated. So it's like, I mean, I grew up in New Jersey, in Plainfield, New Jersey, which is, it's a pretty tough town. So the obstacles are there. I was definitely not someone that at least looked at law enforcement seriously until a challenge was presented in front of me. Like I said, I developed a rapport through a mentorship that I did, a black sergeant, actually. And, you know, he just kind of kept dropping it. Like, you know what? He was like, you're not, you know, satisfied in the work that you were doing. And I really wasn't. Prior to being in law enforcement, I kind of was, you know, number crunching. But they were not going to promote me in the same magnitude as they were going to my peers. So I wasn't satisfied. And my true love, my true passion was, in certain respects, I'll say, like activism or being a part of the community. So I thought that being a police officer would kind of fill that void. I thought that I would get the best of both worlds. I'd be able to actively reach out to my community. And my objective was to actually, and even now, was to keep young brothers out of jail. It was to where applicable, be seen in the community, prevent X, Y, and Z from happening. I don't know. I had a lot of idealistic notions that just, you know, really fell flat over the years, but I was not necessarily someone whom you would have thought would have gone the path of law enforcement. I was very much almost at the opposite extreme. I was very critical of police officers. I was studying. My intent was to be a lawyer. You know, but again, I came across so many police officers who were, at least in Washington, who were on the same, I would say, political objectives as I was, who was like, yo, we've got to do stuff to save these youngins, and we can't just, you know, arrest and shoot and this and that. Like, that's a no-win situation. It's a no-win situation for us. And when you realize that it could be you, that it could be your son, that it could be your daughter, it just forces you to look at things differently. Like, so I came about it because there was that need. There was a need to do something different than what I was doing. And And I was kind of like in, I was sold it in certain respects by a lot of the law enforcement officers that I seen. Like, I seen them in the community. They were doing some good things. They were not at all what I thought that they would be. And becoming a police officer, I had to challenge a lot of notions that I had. Because, again, I was probably far more critical than even the person that was laughing towards police officers. You have no idea if you, and we made mention of it earlier, like I'm writing for a little blog post or whatever. If you would have seen some of my writings in college or some of the discussions that I've had, I was highly critical of the criminal justice system. But I understand that the law enforcement aspect is such a different variable within it. You are given a lot of control. You are given a lot of power. And I wasn't someone that was seeking that power or anything like that. I wanted to redistribute in my mind what that power base was. I wanted to create a more, again, balanced system. I knew that I would not look at that young black dude automatically like he was a threat or he was, you know, going to cause me harm or going to cause somebody harm. And I don't know, I needed a segue, an avenue to do the things that I really wanted to do, the mentoring, the learning, the studying, the putting in, I don't know, it was a tool. It was a tool like anything else.
Thank you.
No problem.
Context of White Supremacy. Thanks everyone for the questions. Have done a little bit past 2 hours before we wrap things up. I did want to ask, this past summer, there was a report that a Washington, D.C. enforcement officer had made a threat against First Lady Michelle Obama. This happened in, yeah, I'm pulling up the date. I'm reading this from the Washington Post. If folks want to check this out, this is from July 12th, 2012. Did you hear about this incident, Mr. Anderson? Is this sounding familiar with the officers?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
It's familiar.
I'll read a little bit just to update listeners if they don't know. And then if you've heard any update on this, what happened with this, there was any investigation, any disciplinary action, they wrote that a D.C. police officer who worked as a motorcycle escort for the White House officials and other dignitaries was moved to administrative duty Wednesday after he allegedly was overheard making threatening comments towards Michelle Obama, according to several police officials. The police department's internal affairs division is investigating the alleged comments and notified the U.S. Secret Service on Wednesday, said the officials, who spoke on the condition of anonymity because they were not authorized to give details of the investigation. The officer allegedly made the comments Wednesday morning on as several officers from the Special Operations Division discussed threats against the Obamas. It was not immediately clear where the alleged conversation took place or how many officers took part in the conversation. During the conversation, the official said the officer allegedly said he would shoot the First Lady and then used his phone to retrieve a picture of the firearm that he said he would use. It was not immediately clear what type of firearm was allegedly shown. You can read the rest of the report. It's on many sites, but I just read that from the Washington Post, July 12th, 2012. Have you heard any updates on this? Any thoughts of a fellow D.C. officer?
I have not heard any updates. I mean, when I heard it then and kind of now, I was almost in disbelief. Like, you know, I don't know. I'm like, I don't know. You'd have to really be an idiot to make that kind of statement in purview of anything, even if you feel that way. But, I mean, I'm not surprised. I'm not surprised, granted the system that we're in. I'm not surprised, granted that it was SOD. That's a whole different, I don't know, they do their own thing. But with respect to the punishment, I was kind of surprised that if it were true that the Secret Service didn't jump on that and in a different magnitude than they did. Because usually, you know, anything that happens to the president or, you know, his wife, obviously, or the children or dignitaries, Secret Service is on top of that. That kind of goes beyond the jurisdiction of Washington Metropolitan Police Department. But, you know, it's, it goes to show the level of disrespect that people have for, obviously, even black people in power. It's unfortunate. I have learned, though, to not be surprised at too much. I mean, anything can and usually will go down. So I wish more black people knew about it. I wish more white people knew about it. I kind of am of the mindset now where I'm really trying to find solutions to things. So I don't know what the best course of action is to punish him. I don't know what can be done. Again, you're not going to, if someone specifically feels that way, there's nothing that you're going to do that's going to change their opinion. Nothing. So if that's the case, and if this is the system that we live under, what do we do? You have the Neely Fuller model where you admit, okay, we're a victim, we're being victimized, okay, but what do you do? And I'm not
trying as much as possible. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I'm good. I was just going to say I don't know what the solution is. I'm hoping when I come to my brothers and sisters that we can find a solution. I'm hoping that we need a solution. We need a solution.
Absolutely, absolutely. Replace white supremacy with justice as soon as possible. I would say getting more non-white people to understand the incident from this past July with First Lady Michelle Obama being threatened by a D.C. enforcement officer, as well as the terroristic abuse of Mr. Anderson in Pittsburgh by a white transit authority is part and parcel of the same global problem, racism, white supremacy. And again, going back to the title of the program, the way that they look at Mr. Anderson, President Barack Obama, First Lady Michelle Obama, Attorney General Eric Holder, as long as the system of white supremacy is in place, you are a nigger. That is your title. Everything else is a distant second and is not going to help you if racist man, racist woman, racist child have designated you as the victim of the hour that they have chosen to abuse. I would say starting right there, making sure that non-white people are honest about that and have a thorough understanding of how that operates worldwide would go a long way to bringing us closer to a solution, understanding what it means to be a white person on this planet anywhere. Thoroughly enjoyed having you on the broadcast to get more information about this. I assume there will be updates as you still have some litigation pending around all this, so we'll be able to follow and see how things transpire. Is there anything you want to let folks know if they want to be on the lookout to get some of your readings or any additional information around what's going to be going down with your court proceedings?
If anyone needs, I guess, if anyone wants to contact me, I mean, you're more than welcome to. My email address is very simply, it's just williamsteanderson@gmail.com. I'm attempting to, you know, shed light on this. I mean, I'm still a grad student. I'm an officer, so my thing is to make sure that this doesn't happen again. I mean, we know it probably will. It's probably already happened 5 times since we talked tonight. But I'm pretty active in the community. I mean, I'm in Washington, D.C. I'm in Pittsburgh. I'm pretty, at least I was, more accessible kind of before the injury. I'll be writing. I'm hesitant to speak on the thing yet because it hasn't been released yet. But if anyone wants to know that information, you can, you know, again, you can contact me at williamsteanderson@gmail.com. As soon as everything is released, I'll be, you know, forwarding it to people. You can ask me questions within reason. Some stuff I can't discuss because it's, you know, pending litigation. So I think a lot of that kind of tempered even my responses to things tonight. So I ask that everybody kind of bear in mind with that, certain things I can't discuss while it's pending because it causes much more harm than it does good. But I'm hoping that it'll be resolved by probably May. Let us hope. then, you know, look out in the future for things on. If you need to see my writing, a lot of it deals with health policy content, law enforcement, and energy policy. Prior to this, I wanted to focus on energy policy and health policy, but, you know, I kind of got to do what hits home. So that's me in a nutshell. I mean, that's it. I'm in D.C. I mean, I perform locally, too. So I actually got a song coming called When You Tase Me. So we're working on it. We're doing some things. I, along with Mike Filson, he's a hip-hop artist. That's my little brother. We got some things coming forward.
Wow, I definitely would. You have an audience waiting to play the song when you all are all done. We will definitely give that some rotation once it's all complete.
It's a good song. I think you'll like it.
I am already excited. Definitely, let us know. We will make sure to get it in rotation on the cows as soon as you're all complete. Do you want to give out your email one more time in case folks need to get a pen or if they missed it? You want to give it to them one more time, so?
I'm not a problem. It's William, WILLIAM, S is in Sam, T is in Time, E is in Edward, so William, STE, Anderson, @gmail.com, and it's ANDERSON. It's all together. William Anderson @gmail.com. And again, you got any questions? Where I'm always dialoguing about this. It's just interesting that it happened to me. I'm not surprised in this given system. So I thank everyone. I hope it was constructive. I enjoyed talking to you. Thank you, Justice, for your questions, if you're still online. And that's it.
Thank you very much. And thank you for the information that you shared today.
No problem.
Right on. Mr. William Anderson, I can even Google his name, and you'll see some of the reports about this particular incident in Pittsburgh and some of his writings as well. You can just Google his name. It'll pop up. Check out some of the descriptions. Keep Norm Stamper and Dr. Wells and keep that in mind when you're reading, and they're talking about this large, wild swinging individual with on phallic symbols, making Dr. Wilson all the way through.
You should have made that earlier. I kind of wish you would have brought it up, but yeah, you know, this big black man.
Yep, it's pretty much laid out. Again, this is, you know, evolving, so we'll keep an eye on this situation as it continues to develop to see where everything heads, and if there are any additional lessons that can be learned as this particular incident comes to a conclusion. But we definitely wish you the best of health. Hope you continue to heal and move through this situation as best you can, and hope you're able to remain as safe as possible on the plantation of white supremacy. We will play our commercial to wrap things up for today's broadcast. Again, we'll be back tomorrow evening, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. We'll be back tomorrow, Friday, and Saturday. So stay tuned. Lots of broadcasts coming up. Hopefully things will be constructive. Check the videos. Finally got the Tarantino video on YouTube.
as well as the incident of terrorism, white supremacy that happened in Alabama just a couple days ago, where a young white man, I think he was 17, had left his notes out. He had taken and made some plans about attacking black students at his school. He had made these homemade bombs and some other incendiary devices and had all these elaborate details, and they captured him. He's in greater confinement now, but this just happened a couple days ago down in Alabama. I did a YouTube video on that as well. Pretty much more of the same. Same thing Mr. Anderson experienced. You can expect more of the same as long as the system of white supremacy is in existence. Thanks, everybody, for tuning into the broadcast. Hope it was a constructive investment of your Wednesday evening. Thank you to Mr. William Anderson III for sharing a bit of his time with us and sharing about what happened to him. We wish him the best. And thanks to all of the folks who dialed in. Tune in tomorrow, same program time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. To the Creator, we just ask that you help us to overstand the importance of words. That might be the best weapon that non-white people have, the use of words. Being more precise, more codified, more conscious of what comes out of our mouth when we are talking to anyone, white person or non-white person. And please aid us in reducing, totally eliminating violence against females. We are really done with that. Really want to be moving on to better things and healthier relationships. No more abuse, violence of black, non-white females. Thank you. Commercial coming up. We will be signing out after the commercial break.
RacismDaily.com, your number one source for global news reports on race, racism, and overt actions of white supremacy. From Asia to the Americas to Europe to Australia to Africa, racism is not a thing of the past. It is our current reality. Be informed. Be globally informed. You should be the first to know. RacismDaily.com, RacismDaily.com, RacismDaily.com.
Is racism hurting you? On issues of race, are you unable to speak, think, and act with clarity and confidence? Are you tired of when nothing is funny, smiling when you are not happy, agreeing when you really disagree? Counterracism.com, you can learn specific strategies and techniques to counter the behaviors of the people who practice racism in all areas of activity. Using words correctly, following counter-racist logic, even counter-racist science projects designed to reveal what racism is, how it works, and how to counter it. The open source code writing format allows you to pick and choose from a variety of counter-racist suggestions so you can produce the code that works for you. Stop by counterracism.com today and help replace racism with justice.
That's counter-racism.com.
Do you need a one-stop shop for all of your multimedia needs? Triumphant Multimedia is a skilled team of professionals with a passion for great marketing and chic design. Our specialties include consulting, brand development, copywriting, and creative graphic design. That's second to none. We also offer photography, photo retouching, videography, and video editing. At Triumphant Multimedia, our goal is to provide highly effective creative solutions built to suit any individual need or budget. Give us a call at 678-732-8067 or check us out online at TRIMultimedia.com.
Hi everyone, welcome. This is Justice with the Cows Radio program. If you want to learn about, understand, and counter racism, white supremacy, be sure not to miss a Cows episode. We keep them jammed, packed with constructive information to sharpen your use of words, to help eliminate the system of racism, white supremacy, ASAP. Also, to be able to invest in my counter-racist efforts, co-hosting the COW's radio program, please visit my blog, justdojusticetoday.blogspot.com.
You're just saying just buckets and buckets of work.
I got an uncle real crazy. My Uncle B, 55 years old, hates white people, married to a white lady. And he's sitting around going, you know, these crackers ain't shit, except for Susan. And he tried to explain the whole thing to me one day, say, yeah, I got a white wife, I love her, she love me, that's all that matter. But I tell you this, if the revolution ever come, I'll kill her first. Just to show these crackers I mean business. Motherfucking cracker ass, motherfucking cracker. Shit, cracker, motherfucker. What? Hey, hi, honey. Motherfucking cracker, I'll kill my cracker kids too.